People are not that interested, maybe they're not that worried about this. Good morning, everybody. We are going to go through and talk to you today about flexible learning environments and what they mean to us here at SAS and some of the things that we've learned. And it'll be quite interactive, so that's why we're asking you to be with other people so that you can have the discussion so we can build our understanding.
We want to start just with the slide of community norms. I'll give you a moment. So when I think back to my school experience, this is where I did most of my learning. It was in a desk. It was a desk with a chair attached. In the industry, they call them cages. How many cages will you need? Because they're kind of like a cage. It was in a classroom, we were in rows, we all faced the front. And my daily...
Sometimes you go side by side.
Yeah, if you were the really progressive teacher, that's right. You would be like two side by side partners, but you just couldn't talk too much or they would move you. So it was a delicate balance. And I'm sure that many of you, hands up if you were in a similar context. Most of us. Time was also delineated really specifically in my life, and specifically by subject. We learned math, and math was done. We learned math for exactly 1 hour, and if you were done early, you did something else, or you looked like you were doing math and then were sneaky. I used to always have a book in my desk, and if I leaned back just the right way, I could read it if I got my math. But it's very
sneak that.
I just sneak it, absolutely. It was very compartmentalized.
If we look back at the point, I know that this is not new thinking or talking about this with you, but when we look back at how at least our public education system in kind of our Western democracies, that education for all, it was really to build a modestly educated workforce for the age that we were in at the time, which was the industrial. We don't need that kind of workforce anymore, right? That is not, we don't need the factory model kind of workforce. We need, as we all know, if you think about kind of economies like the US economy, a huge percentage of the US economy is services, not goods. It's mental work, it's cognitive work. It's not only the building of things. And so our schools are working to adapt to really focus on those skills that will allow our kids to be able to do that next level of work.
So our targets for today, I'll give you a moment to read. And for the bottom one there, we'll reflect on what is working well in the middle school and give you a sense of our next.
Okay, so we, as you are all well aware, I hope, many years ago went through a pretty rigorous research and development process here at Singapore American School, where we visited other schools, we did tons of reading, we had a development team at each division who put forth recommendations that were then kind of endorsed by our school board for the strategic direction of the school. And some of the reasons that we, when we look at our desired student learning outcomes, which you see around this room here, yes, we have a big set of content knowledge of specific things that kids need to know, right? Facts, skills, mathematical understandings, science content. But the other ones are all those cognitive skills we were just talking about, right? The ones that help people to be able to do the kind of work that most of our kids will do. Tony Wagner, who is a thought leader in this field, you can see the ones that he talks about. They're very similar to our desired student learning outcomes. Forbes in the last summer was looking at the big important skills for the workplace now and into the future. And what I love about this is they actually kind of do it on a scale, right? And it kind of a, I do it all on my own. I'm full of raw emotion. I only believe things if I see them, but rather than building up to where you get in these higher levels of these skills. This is Grant McMinn, who has done, he visited, how many schools was it? 16,
I think he tells us.
Okay. He's another thought leader in the education field about the future of schools. We'll listen a little bit to what he has to say.
Or
here it
goes.
So where do we really want to be? You know, now I'm just trying to synthesize 600 interviews and 10,000 miles on the road, and then one long drive. I had a concept, and then I distilled it down to three sentences, and then I distilled it down to a phrase, and then down to three words, and I finally said, you know what? No, this all comes down to, I think, one single word. Where do we want to be as educators? What does great learning look like? And you all know that that's what great learning looks like. In all those schools I visited, in all those bright lights that I was privileged to see, all that sharing I did with all those teachers, not a single one of them would John Dewey have been unhappy with. We know what great learning looks like. Dewey and Montessori and Parker, 100, 125 years ago, told us what that looked like. And so why is it so hard for us to get back to that? Why have we yielded that high ground of the progressive era of education to the industrial age model that's been implanted on us? I think there are three things that keep us from getting back to Dewey. The first one is that we, the adults, have constructed a series of anchors. These anchors are based on ego and our control, our intent to control education rather than that being controlled by the students. And those anchors are three. There are that egotistical attraction to time, space, and subject. This is my classroom, my subject, my time. The second one are dams that we have built. As you look at schools, and I've visited a lot of schools for K-12s and K-6s and all these different grade levels, you see these marvelously metacognitive kids, and as others have said, that innovation is marvelous, creativity is marvelous, and then we just sort of beat it out of them as we cram them into these quantum packets of time, space, and subject. And by the time we get to the high schools and upper schools, the two biggest dams that were mentioned to me, the College Board and the College Admissions Offices that want us to shove those kids into packets of content rather than context. And the third are the silos that we've constructed around ourselves that prohibit us, that keep us, the structures that were mentioned earlier, that keep us from communicating, from collaborating, from networking, all the things that we know over 500 years of innovation, best practices, and the Renaissance are key to innovation and change. We've built ourselves into these silos of classroom, department, division, school. We're very inwardly focused, and we don't really get out to see what's possible out there in the world. The schools that have started to trim these anchors, to cut them, to break down the dams, to breach the silos are those where innovation is exploding, and it's a marvelous, beautiful thing to see. So in a time of rapid change, what do we really have to do? How do we reduce this down to these singular goals? We need to teach into the unknown. By definition, in a time of rapid change in the world, we don't know what the future looks like, and therefore we have to teach into the unknown, and that's difficult, uncomfortable, messy, and unfamiliar to us, and we need to learn a different set of skills for that. Also, by definition, if the world is changing rapidly like this, we don't know that the skills that we're talking about today, we call them 21st century skills, and I hate that term, I think they're timeless skills that have defined success and happiness throughout human history. We don't know necessarily that those are the skills that our students are going to need in their future, so we need to teach them to be self-evolving learners so that they can meet whatever challenges crop up in the world in the next 30 or 40, 50 years of their lifetime. And in order for us to teach students to be self-evolving learners, we need to become self-evolving organizations. We're not good at that. We haven't been good at that in the past, but we really, really need to. We need to embrace constant change and the methodology of constant change.
It's interesting. One of the things I think that's hardest for us as parents and as educators is that we all have the framework for what school is. We all did school. It worked for all of us, right? We all have, and the self-evolving part is really hard. Schools are super, super slow at that. You think about medicine, they are not slow. If there's a new procedure that works better, that's more successful, every doctor who does that kind of procedure learns how to do it as quickly as they can. And schools are slow because we all trust the doctors because none of us are doctors, right? But we all went to school. Right? So we all have this paradigm of what works because it worked for us. And so I think that's one of the things that slows us down. So we are really focusing on trying to be that self-evolving institution, that self-evolving organization that's always trying to get a little bit better and to do things. So, Chris, sorry.
So you heard Grant Lichtman talk about it, but we really do, as he said, cram our students into quantum packets of space, time, and subject. And so what we're going to talk about today is how a flexible learning environment can help our school develop so that our kids become self-evolving learners. So the question mark shouldn't be on this slide,
oops,
but the intent is correct, which is, if you could read the front page of the article we handed out, if you don't have one, let us know. But if you could read the front page and turn and talk with the person beside you when you're done.
Was it a question originally?
I think it was.
And then thank you. Golden section. So turn and talk at your table with somebody about what you read.
I know, and I'm here.
Yeah, Okay, we're gonna ask you just to sort of wrap up that conversation. We're gonna have plenty of time to have other conversations as we sort of progress through that. So as we work through the rest of this presentation, what we're going to do is sort of address each of those sort of silos one at a time, and how a flexible learning environment kind of works towards sort of breaking those silos down. So the first one we're going to talk about is time, right? And it's the one thing we never seem to have enough of, and of course in the eyes of our students.
Right. Or adults.
Or adults sometimes do it. Yes, that's true. So what we're gonna ask you to do is just to do a quick little exercise around time. On the tables, in front there's these little tiny slips of paper. Okay, and so we want each person to take their own. And all we're gonna ask you to do is just to make an estimate. How long would it take you to do each of those five tasks? Right? How long would it take you to run or maybe walk 5 kilometers? How long would it take you to label a map of Europe with all of the countries? How long would it take you to pack for a 1-week trip? Solve 10 multi-step equations in math, and to read, and it just says read here, but let's say read and annotate a 15-page article. And just in case you're not sure what some of those things are, that would be an example of a multi-step equation in mathematics. Okay. This is when we're talking about the countries in Europe. That's what we're talking about. Okay. Lauren pointed out who packs like that.
Apparently, these guys do.
People sheepishly went.
I got back from a soccer tournament last night. My suitcase.
So take a couple minutes and just give your best estimate of how long it would take you to do each of those 5 tasks.
Yeah. Let's go just.
Put a time estimate on.
The first one is just like it's just the reading and reading an article. So read and annotate a 15-page article.
15 pages.
Yeah, there should be a piece of paper on. Yeah, it's right there.
Oh.
Yeah. Adaptation might be noted, questions about what you're reading. When you're done putting your times on there, compare with the other people at your table. Compare with the other people at your table. Where are they? Where are the things where maybe you were more similar in the amount of time it took you to accomplish a task? And what were the things that maybe you were more different in the time it took to accomplish a task?
So,
and it's okay no matter what time you put, that's okay.
So
Which is like.
You're not packing.
Yes.
I packed all my.
He can not only know, I have to remember.
That's where the packing is. We do it by kit. Yeah. So it'd be like, yeah. You need four shirts, four dresses, or whatever.
Okay. We're gonna pull you back together here. So obviously, as you were comparing, you probably noticed some differences, right? So I was kind of, you know, going around the room and peeking over people's shoulders. And, you know, I saw, for example, I saw for the 5-kilometer run, I saw numbers as small as 20 minutes and numbers as high as 60 minutes. Maybe I missed some others, right? The labeling a map of Europe, I saw numbers as low as 5 minutes and numbers as high as 1 day. packing a 1 week trip, I didn't actually get to see the high. I thought 5 minutes is a low end for that. Right?
We have a week, right?
Right? And a week, right? Just as long packing is for the trip, right? Solving 10 multi-step equations, I saw numbers as low as 5 minutes and numbers as high as 1.5 hours. Right? Reading a 15-page news article. I didn't actually get that. I saw someone wrote forever. Right? And I don't remember what I saw as a low number.
I saw 15 minutes as low.
15 minutes? Okay. So the idea here is, of course, it's just like our students, we all have certain things that we naturally are quicker at accomplishing, and we all have things that naturally take us longer to accomplish. Yet, when you think back to that schedule that Chris showed at the very beginning, you know, the way that most traditional schools are structured is we designate the exact same amount of time for every student to accomplish the same tasks. But the reality is that is not how we operate as adults, and it's not how students operate as well. So we're going to have you do a quick grab, you do a little reading. Now you get to practice reading that article. Right. It's not 15 pages though. So what we're going to ask you to do is read the sections, and we're going to talk about the time piece a little bit more, but we're going to have you read the sections on flexible time and flexible student grouping on the second page. It's
bottom of the second page, and then through to near the bottom of the third page. Okay, so we're not necessarily following this article in order. We'll come back to other pieces.
It's tiny.
finish reading those two sections, just turn to someone else on the table and share something that resonates with you based on the activity we just did, as well as what you read in those two sections. Just one thing that you're like, yeah, that makes sense. Okay, I apologize. I'm gonna ask you to wrap up. Obviously, based on what we learned, some of you maybe had more time to talk, and some of you maybe had less time to talk, depending on the article. So what we want to talk about here is how does a flexible learning environment actually, right now in our school, what are some of the things that we're doing that kind of put these things into practice? And one of the things that we talk a lot about with our teachers is how, that flexible learning environment has different components, right? We're talking about time, but there's also a little bit of an intersection with space. And I guess what we mean by that is, in some of our renovated spaces, it does allow some of these things to happen more easily. And it's a phrase that we use a lot when we talk with parents, is that more easily piece. These things aren't impossible to do in a more traditional building. They just happen much more easily in a renovated space that's been purposely designed to be able to do these types of things. So a couple of examples, right? You may have heard your child talk about something called flex time. And flex time is something that came out of some of the work that we did last year that ended up being this really great success that we now sort of carried over throughout the entire school. And some of the things, and that flex time is really about shifting time. The flex time part is much more, it's formalized, where teams actually develop a specific schedule for that. It's kind of like an event for kids. But that idea of flexing time doesn't just happen during flex time, right? One of the things we're working with our teachers with thinking about is how can we flexibly use the time within that 83-minute period of time to more easily meet the needs of students. So here are just a couple of examples of things that we are seeing happen right now. So in our renovated spaces, where we have more closer proximity of groups of teachers, is it actually allows to have more adults available to make use of that flexible grouping piece to provide extra support for students who need it, while at the same time providing an extension for students who need that as well. So that's that idea of how a flexible learning environment can actually, we can really leverage that flexible grouping as a strategy.
There's some edgy babble up there. RTI right. is an educator term for responding to interventions, whether the intervention for a kid is an extension to push them further, or an intervention might be a reteaching because they didn't get it or they have some gaps, right? So it allows for that grouping to happen flexibly, and then the visual that you can have the adults there and not have the walls between means you can have kids doing other things while you're pulling those small groups with different
groups. One of the things that teachers have kind of realized themselves as well is, sometimes, I was teaching here as well, right? Where we had, I'd have my five classes and you want to show them a short 20-minute video. Well, you're showing a short 20-minute video five times throughout the day or throughout 2 days. You know, maybe if you have a space that allows it, maybe it's actually more beneficial to show that 20-minute video to the whole group at one time, to all five of your classes. In a traditional space, you can't do that. But in a more in a flexible learning environment where the space more easily allows that, and you're flexing the time, it allows for us to sort of leverage those types of moments in a more effective way. These flex schedules really are an amazing thing that's starting to happen, and these are just a variety of things that our students are experiencing during this flexible time, where we've sort of said, sort of from the point of view of, we know that not every student needs the same amount of time to do the same thing. If we know that to be true, what can we do about it? And that's a lot of where that flex time came in.
One of the things we've also been being really overt with our teachers is we're trying to change the language we use around time. Teachers will often say, well, I don't want to take it out of my time, right? Like, they don't want to give up their class time. And we are being really explicit, like, this is the kids' time. This is the kids' time to learn. You don't own the time. It's what do they need? What time do they need to learn? So we're trying to kind of change the frame around whose time it is here at school, and it's the kids, right? The kids' learning time.
So we started doing this. Flex time thing last year. And one thing that we often get asked about when we're talking about the work that we're doing at our school is, well, how do you know that it's working? Right, and so when we answer that question, we kind of do a couple of things. One is we look at research. We want to make sure that what we're doing is has a research kind of connection to it. But we also want to make sure that we're getting feedback from our end user, who in this case, of course, are our students. So 6A last year, this survey was done last year. 6A was the group that really sort of spearheaded this idea of using flex time as a way to better leverage the space. And we asked students, if you could choose between a flex day schedule and a regular schedule, which one would you choose? And you can kind of see here that it's a ridiculously high number. So 97% of students said they would prefer to have some flexible time built into every day, that's 56%, or at the very least as part of the week. We had a super, super small number.
Which would have been at the most two kids.
Yeah, two kids, maybe 101 responses, three kids. Who said, I never want to have a flex day. Right? So for the vast majority of our learners, they are recognizing that this actually serves their needs better as a learner.
Sorry, this is class-based students.
This was just 6A, because this was the first group last year that was really doing this.
So we'll capture this data, we'll ask the same questions from all the sixth grade students this year again, but this was last year's group. We haven't surveyed the kids yet.
So 101.
108.
Yeah.
Probably
108. Right? So every year we have somewhere around 106 to 108 students per team. So 101 students responded.
Question for me, just
looks
more like, would you like to have
flexible
time during the shorter class period?
That's a good question. So we have to remember at this point, the students have had experience with this, and they understand that it doesn't mean you have. Right, it comes back to that thinking about time as not just being a 50-minute versus an 80-minute chunk of math, or a 50-minute versus an 80-minute chunk of science. The students are still doing math and doing ELA and doing science during the flex time. They're just getting some choice as to which thing they need to work on the most.
Of where they need more time.
So, for example, right? This is a schedule that one of the teams, this was actually a seventh grade team that last year sort of went, hey, this is great, we're going to jump on board as well. And you can kind of see here, right, what was sort of happening is students were given the flexibility and the responsibility to start making some choices about how they use their time, which is a skill we actually want them to develop. And so you can kind of see here that they're still working on academic things that they would be working on in their class times anyway. We're just starting to give them the choice in recognition that not every kid needs 80 minutes to complete the same math task. Some were able to complete it in the 55 minutes or the 60 minutes, and then instead recognize that they could probably use some more support or some more time even with one of the other things that they were being asked to do in one of their other classes.
One of the things that, parents often ask and the teachers at first were really leery of, they were like, well, what about those kids who are just gonna go and they are gonna go do the climbing in the rock gym even though they don't need to, and they really do need to work on their expressions in math. And they got really worried about this when we first rolled this out. And what they found is it's a handful of kids. Out of 100 kids, it might be 5. And those 5 kids are really easily reaffected. But what they found, and it was actually a faculty, I was in a meeting where we were talking about this, and one of the faculty members had their child on the side doing this. And her daughter does not like to run. And when they ran, it was this one, actually, the mild pacing workshop. Her daughter went to that and chose it. She said, I couldn't get her to run for all the money in the world, but she knew she needed to work on it. And so she chose that as one of her options. And what we're finding is our kids want to do really well. The number of kids that don't, or the number of kids that make really poor choices, is actually quite small. The other thing that we pushed our teachers to do was to let them make the poor choice, because then they have a really logical consequence. It's not the end of the world if a student misses 30 minutes of something that they probably should have had, but it's a really good learning opportunity the next day in math class to say, oh, well, what did you pick yesterday? Now, what are we going to do at lunch or after school? Figure that out. So it's a little scary. I think at first the thought of it, but what we're finding is that we can redirect kids when we need to, and the majority of kids don't.
You can see how many kids thought they needed help, but they're in the news, whether that was practicing it or whatever, versus they chose in here. They signed up on a Google form for the sessions that they wanted. They made their own schedule for those chunks of time each day.
And you can see actually here, when this number got high enough, they put an extra teacher in there. So Joel Olson went in with Lee Kernay to be able to support, because 27 is a big number, so they had that flexibility to roll in.
Yeah, and the same thing happened with Route 2.
How far in advance
did they choose their? Yeah, it's timely, so sometimes 2 days before or the day before, depending. Yeah.
And you can see there was an example of an extension group, right, doing the coding. You also had 2 teachers in there.
How is this working? It's like if my child's in Ms. Buckmill's class.
No.
So this is the schedule that was rolled out to students. This was just which teacher was facilitating
that session.
That particular session.
So kids had 4 slots where they could pick something. So if I knew if I might pick integer operations review, I want to work on my ITN, I'm gonna work on my mile, and then I'm gonna go and so the students would pick work, sometimes be assigned.
Yeah, and the teachers do is they might say, Chris, I know you probably want to do the history breakout because you love history, but I need to see you in the analyzing and data, right? So
yeah.
You can do the history on day 2, but let's do that data stuff first to make sure you get it.
Right. Yeah, I mean, the reality is, of course, we all want the same thing, and that is we want our kids to be able to make good choices. Right, because as adults, they need to be making good choices about how they use their time. We also know that they're 12 years old, and they might not always make good choices. So we're gonna support them, and we're gonna scaffold in terms of making those choices. So as Chris said, sometimes they make a bad choice. We're not gonna let them repeatedly make bad choices. Right, and if it's something that they is absolutely critical that they're there for, we're gonna guide students to be.
Who's going to supervise and who's going to see which kids choose what and then which kids made a poor choice and try to redirect? Is it home teacher or?
They assign kids as a team. So they'll sit down and look at what the kids signed up for together. So then as the math teacher, I'd look at the sessions I'm running and I'd go, oh, you know what? Chris Ray's missing. I'm going to actually talk to him in class today and switch out one. Yeah.
And then those schedules are given to the students maybe 2-3 before?
Or the morning of, they know what they signed up for. So they would get that because they signed up.
But the sign up going to happen 2-3 days before?
Or it could happen that morning, because maybe the test is 2 days from now and they realize, okay, I still don't know how to do this thing with the integers. I'm going to go to the extra session on integers. So we try to make it as timely as we can.
But
so
the teachers also have to plan the lessons. So.
I'm sorry, how often does it take? How often do you have this?
It depends on the teams. Right now, we have like one of our sixth grade teams does it almost all the time for chunks of time. Other teams do it every kind of white day, so 2 out of 6 days. Some teams have only done it once this semester. With our sixth grade teams, they are doing it more, and we're working with our seventh and eighth grade teams to get themselves comfortable. So it's a variety right now. I think we want to move on a little bit from this because we still have space and subject to get to.
But Dory, I think we'll stick around at the end. That's just another example. Okay, so the second silo that we want to talk about is space. And you know, as we sort of alluded to earlier, this is the work environment, the work space that our more traditional educational model, when it was sort of conceived of, was sort of working kids towards. Right? We want to make sure that when students enter the workforce, that they are prepared for whatever that work environment looks like. And what we're starting to see now, of course, is that work environments don't look like this anymore. Right? Work environments tend to be a lot more modern. And so what we have here is we're actually going to have you watch this. It's a 2-minute video. It's a promotion. It's a promotional video for Lego Singapore. So if anyone's been there, this is the Lego head office here in Singapore. And I had the opportunity to visit that office last year, beginning of last year. And as you're watching the video, we want you to pay attention to a couple of things. What type of spaces do you see being used? So think about the size of the spaces. Right? Think about this: are the spaces more individual in nature, or are they more collaborative in nature? That's that second question. What do you notice about the different sizes? And then the last one: what do you notice about the type of furniture that's being used in the space?
I can't see.
There's nothing to see.
I want to make it. Can I make it great size?
I think it's fine.
Is it okay?
Well, no, I think we're
not. I don't think it's okay.
I think we're missing half of it.
Yeah. Sorry. Apparently you can't embed Vimeo on size. Hang on. Also, I've learned that the aspect ratio is different on my computer than on the projector. It'll be back, I promise.
There you go. Thank you. said, obviously a promotional video, right? Lots of good shots of cafeterias, lattes, all very good things. And this isn't unique. Like, Lego is not unique in this case, right? Your Google head office is similar. Lawrence was at Khan Academy.
I was at Khan Academy a couple weeks ago. Similar layout. Everybody, there were dogs in the offices.
Right. So that's the work environment that we're trying to, that we want to prepare kids to be successful for. And so when we think about, you know, how do we prepare students for that, we need to think about being able to work and be comfortable in a more flexible space. Just in the interest of time, I'm just going to kind of go through some of the things I know that I noticed when I was looking at this. Types of spaces, you know, there are those individual kind of desks that people working there had access to, but then there were also like smaller kind of group rooms, right? There were breakout rooms that had, you know, sort of tables for 3 and 4. There were also some of those larger tables that had looked like they maybe had like 6 to 8 people kind of working there. When I was at the head office there, you know, they also have larger meeting spaces that kind of have round tables, kind of like these, that are maybe about 10 to kind of 12 people in size. Also, from a furniture perspective, right, you had, there's a combination of much more traditional furniture, but then also some more, quote unquote, kind of modern contemporary furniture, stools and, you know, softer stools and higher stools. You have like the booth there. That people can kind of hang out in. So there's a much greater variety of what's there in terms of furniture and in terms of spaces. This is something that's actually super cool, and they scroll through this really quickly, but this is something that I want to point out. These are the norms that they have, the rules of engagement for how you use this space as an employee, right? And so they talk about, right, work in whatever way makes you most effective, providing it doesn't impact the effectiveness of others. That is their overarching rule of engagement. Use the facilities only as intended, eating only designated areas, no camping. That's actually, and they don't mean don't bring your tent, although they probably mean that as well. What they mean by no camping is nobody in the Lego head office has an office. Nobody. Actually, that's not true. The exception is the eight Lego kit developers. They have a secret room that no one's allowed into. But no, nobody else has an office. And so, and if you end up going to the same space repeatedly to work, someone will actually come and talk to you about that. Because they want the space to be flexible. They want people to be mixing with different individuals, with collaborating with a high number of other people. And so, once again, when we think about the spaces that we're trying to design for students, we're trying to be mindful of this is where that's headed. So we're actually now going to ask you to go, this is actually kind of, this was earlier, this is on page 2, the flexible physical space section of the article. And as you read, think about how are the things in this article, how were those sort of represented or manifested in that video you saw from the Lego head office?
All right, we have some photos, which might bring some of the text to life. This is in the 6B learning community. And so you can see in there, there's, I mean, pretty traditional looking students working at tables, but we have some different heights. These are
super popular.
They're quite quiet, which is the part that I asked when they were told us we were going to order them, but the kids can pedal, so their feet can be moving. These stools are hilarious, so they're called a boy, and we ordered them. So one thing we're really intentionally doing in these spaces is trying out different furniture, see what really works for the kids.
What kids go to, what they like,
what works for them, what maybe doesn't work for them. So these are hilarious because they're really small. Sixth graders they're hydraulic and they don't have enough weight to bring them down. So they sit on it and they're kind of goofing around at first, and they push the little handle and they get shot up into the air, and then they can't quite manage it. So they might be better for some kids not to be.
In eighth grade.
In eighth grade especially. There's like a kid, a student at my home base, and I'm always like helping her push the stool down. Got it? A variety of seating is what they say. The research on furniture says kids need to experience a variety throughout the day. So we actually did some classroom furniture refresh starting 3 years ago.
Yeah.
And we really intentionally rolled out through all spaces. You know, we rolled out 20 of this design and then 20 of a different design because kids do need some variety. Here's some soft seating, some beanbag chairs. Trying to more accurately replicate a space you would read a book in at home.
And do you think about when you read for yourself for pleasure, read a book, are you often sitting at a desk?
Here's a small group together. There's more of those boys. See, like, it's kind of precariously balanced there. Here, you can't see it entirely, but it's a different kind of soft seating, which actually, that one's really interesting because you can turn it on its side and then it becomes a different way to sit. And there's some sort of more couch-like furniture in the back. This, I think, is Ms. McCoy's home base. Going through something. Just a shot from the science lab, which still, I mean, science lab needs big wood tables to do experiments on, and that's what they have. This is on 6C. You can see, again, the kids having some choice around. There's some soft seating here that some students are at. This young man's on the floor, and then there's some more.
I just have one question. Mm-hmm. How good is it with, in terms of focus? Because I'm just thinking, you know, I'm trying to get my middle schooler to do her homework rather than sitting on the bed with her laptop, I would sit at the desk have that structured space.
That's a good question. And actually, there's a lot of, especially with middle schoolers who they're physically, their need for physical, if they are physically uncomfortable, they cannot focus. And you know, and we also think about, you know, when the laptop is the distraction, right? It's not the space. It's every distraction in the entire world is right there.
And I think the photos might be a little misleading. Like, this is
a lesson.
Mr. Fine doing the direct instruction portion of a lesson, as is that, as is this. This isn't. This would be when they're going to do silent reading. This year, they all have a task, and they're set to it, and they're sitting at tables, and they're doing that task.
So it's based on what the activity is, right? But in that space, he was really leading the kids through a lesson that was, so it was just how they could be most focused.
Yeah, I think a couple of things that you don't necessarily see here. I'm just thinking back to that Lego video. Is like, you can kind of just see on the very far left edge of that photo, there are also small breakout rooms in these spaces as well. And the small breakout rooms are actually designed with sort of two main things kind of in mind. Number one, it's a space for breakout to occur, but we also strategically kind of place them in such a way that they start to divide up the space a little bit, right? So it comes back, I think we have a slide coming up in a moment about what a flexible learning environment is not.
There's a breakout space there as well. Yeah.
I mean, I think about myself, right? I have a standing desk. And I very rarely have it down, because if I'm sitting, I can't. I don't work as well as if I'm standing. So I'm up here. I'm at the standing desk. Even at home, I have a kitchen island. I really want to get something done, that's where I put my computer and I stand there and do it.
And it's about helping the kids realize, oh, you know what? It's terrible for me when I'm on the board. I fall off. I am so distracted, and helping them start to recognize
the teachers
that.
Do that. It seems like you're having trouble with that chair.
Yeah. I mean, again, we all have the same end goal, which is our kids to be learning and self-regulating, and there's lots of teaching. It's just not the teaching we got in school.
Nothing
was ever about anything but the subject and the content, whereas there's a lot more self-regulation pieces. There is some misconceptions, so we have a couple slides we'll let you read through.
How many of you have been on the learning walks that the school's done? Yeah, so some of you have seen, you've probably seen a variety of the spaces being used in different ways.
We're going to talk next about that purposeful disciplinary connections part. We are going to move on to talk about subject. This was how I experienced subject. We would do things in social studies, we would read something in social studies, and it never related to the instruction on how we were taught to read in language arts. Things were very disparate.
One thing that we hear kids, or we used to hear them say, these kinds in the classroom a decade ago, but this is an English class. How come why are you checking my spelling? Right? This is an English, like, it was so compartmentalized in their minds that they shouldn't be held accountable for something in another subject in that class.
In addition to that, I think, you know, when I was teaching math on 7C, I remember once Craig Dirksen, who's a social studies teacher there, coming to me one day and being like, "No, the students should know how to calculate percentages, right?" Like, yeah, they should know how to calculate. We do that all the time. They've got that. It's like, yeah, I asked them to calculate percentages in social studies, and he wasn't even getting the why are you asking us to do math? He was getting the, we don't know how to do this.
The transfer was
not
obvious.
Yeah, just that taking that math skill and transferring it into a different situation for those kids, it just didn't make sense to them.
And the thing about this really specific subject division is it was done in response in the late 1800s, in response to the randomness that was occurring in American public education. So in 1892, the Committee of Ten decided that there would be these specific discipline divisions in schools. Over 100 years ago, and we still see it in a lot of our traditional schedules.
And it was like an accountability.
Yeah.
It was around accountability so that each school had a certain things that they had to make sure that they taught in science or in mathematics.
All right. It's a lovely house. Happens to be a house that I built. I didn't build personally. I had it built back before we moved to Singapore. And what and all of you have rented houses. You've had to make those decisions. What I want you to think about is all of the different skills that you need to be proficient at in order to rent or purchase or even build a home. Right down from, you need to be able to know that you're gonna have enough square feet or square meters to fit that sectional that you lovingly purchased, to you need to be able to negotiate with the realtor or with the builder or with the landlord. So I want you at your table, take a couple minutes, think about the different skills you need to be proficient at in order
to build, buy, or rent a house.
Yeah.
All right, who wants to share something their group came up with? You could share what your neighbor said. Less threatening that way. Tell us what your friend said. I heard geography. I heard location. I've heard you want to have the worst house on the nicest block. That's geography. Geography piece. What are some?
If you're renting,
no.
The best house on the block.
The best house, yeah.
Adopting, evaluation.
Sure.
Research.
Yeah.
Negotiation.
Yeah. Yeah. All that.
Can you repeat that?
Oh, sorry. Now you're testing my short term. Accounting, planning, you have to research, you have to be able to
analyze
and evaluate. Yeah.
Prioritize,
yeah. Is it more important that we have square footage or we're closer to where we want to be is often a common trade-off. Anything else?
Accounting.
Yeah. Accounting, can we afford it? Is it worth what we're gonna pay? All right.
What are the hidden costs?
What are the hidden? Yeah, how old is it? All right, so now we'll bring you back to your article for the last time. The last page, or the second last page and the last page.
Okay, we are conscious of time, so.
So why don't you take a moment, when we talk about interdisciplinary learning, we're talking about learning that crosses through many or through multiple subject areas. So here's a little bit of research on that.
When you think about that adult decision that you just were processing at your table about the home, and you think about the higher level thinking, the decision making, right, all of making choices, all of those things that are those adult brain skills.
As Chris Ray talked to you about before, we were regularly getting feedback from our end user, from our kids, in terms of the learning environment. So this is some feedback from the end of last year, and we'll replicate this again this year. But when we talk about our kids having that opportunity to make connections between subjects, this was our students in 6A, so the majority, vast majority, agreed and strongly agreed that they saw those connections. And this was a cumulative 6B and 6C. So you can see there's far more in the disagree category.
And far fewer in the strongly agree.
Yeah.
How do you do that this year for all?
Well, we'll do the whole school, actually. Yeah, now we'll have people here.
And then another thing we looked at here is talking about that ability to make decisions and being actively engaged in part of your learning. And on 6A, you can see the number that agree and strongly agree that they have opportunities to make decisions about how they learn. So likely we're seeing this as a symptom of the flex time and some of the interdisciplinary learning.
And the furniture and the movement.
Yeah.
And I think one of the things that's hard for us as parents is they can't get good at making decisions unless we let them make decisions. Right? And we don't want them to make some of the decisions because sometimes they make bad ones, right? And then we want to protect them from those bad decisions. But they can only learn how to make good decisions by making some bad ones, right? So it's this whole process. So they may have had the opportunity to make decisions about how they learn. They may not have always made the right one, but they had the opportunity to make the decision.
So that's been a lot of information. We want to give you a little bit of time at your table. There's file cards. And there's five questions. If you want to pick two or three, and just jot down what you think might be some answers that you could give if someone asked you, oh, I missed that parent coffee. What's that about? What did you learn about why we have the new learning space? Why we want flexibility? Why we want collaboration? Why we want our kids to self-navigate a little bit more?
One of the things that I think we failed to mention here very well, too, is one of the things about the collaboration problem through money. The research on learning and brain has come a long way since we were all went to school. And the recommended now time for teacher talk versus kids talking, kids learn the most when they are doing the talking. The research is now the maximum being 25% teacher talk, right? So every time when we hear noise in the space, that's a good thing. That means that the kids are talking and learning, right? If the teacher is talking more than 25% of the time, they're stealing opportunities. Now, obviously, there may be days where that's not possible, but that's kind of a goal, right? And so that's one of the things that this collaboration, not only between the teachers, but also between.
And when you talk about percentages of teachers talking versus students talking, what percentage of the time are the kids just led by their laptop or on their laptop or learning on their laptop?
We monitor that. That's an earlier parent coffee where we talked about that. But
in the class.
Yeah, I mean, and I guess it depends, right? The laptop is a tool, and so sometimes that's the right tool, and sometimes it's not.
So the writing they're going to be using.
Yeah.
It's below 50%.
Yeah, so we do survey and we do like we'll take 20 minutes and check every room in the school and then calibrate that. And we had a consultant come in 2016 who did a really thorough analysis of it. It's less than half.
And when kids are on the laptop, they are often collaborating.
Yeah.
Right. They will have their laptops open. They'll be working together. For example, on a presentation on their sustainability unit. And so all three of them will have the slide deck open, and they'll be talking through as they edit and add things to it. So the tool is there. I mean, that's how we work. We sat to prepare this coffee, but the three of us all had our laptops. We had it open. We were going through. Somebody's popping photos in. Somebody's changing things around. I'm moving slide 21 down to 27. Okay, put the notes in the bottom. You know, like that's how the work happens. It was real work.
I guess that's thinking more like a math class where only 25% of the time teachers instructing, I've seen examples of like where the kids will be engaging with like a program on the screen to teach them a concept through like a math program. Yeah, the IXL. I don't think that's pervasive. You can't hear well in the back. Sorry. She's asking about like in math when they use the IXL or other online math lessons
or tutorials.
Now, are you referring to like IXL where they're practicing a skill or when they're going to, let's say, like YouTube or Khan Academy to learn a skill?
I guess I'm asking you, because you're saying 25% of the time the teacher should be speaking, but in a math class, I'm just wondering how does that work? Because I've seen videos where like the kids are engaging with the laptop learning a skill, whether it's Khan Academy or IXL, or, you know,
So I think that what that 25% means is
the direct instruction.
That direct instruction.
Yeah.
should be no more than a quarter of the class. So if you're talking for longer than that, you actually shouldn't be, you should probably be circulating and helping
kids. You're not giving kids the one-on-one feedback,
yeah.
They're not having time to practice, they're not having time to process or synthesize. Sometimes the practice may be through an exercise on the laptop. Like we know, you see in the science lab, they'll be able to change variables and watch how it goes out, so because they can do things, you know, they can do the same experiment 300 times in an hour if they are changing variables and keeping track of that, right? So sometimes it's stuff like that.
Does
that help? Okay, so you can take a few minutes to think through.
That's the end of our presentation.
Okay, you want to go?
Yeah.
We're gonna skip through some of this stuff because we know it's time to go. So how is everything going? Here are some things that students have said. These are direct quotes. We also had a consultant in a few weeks back, before October break actually, so it's a while ago now. And she said when she talked to a bunch of kids on all of the sixth grade teams, and there were things that they said that were surprising to her because they were unintended consequences, right? She said she sought out kids who she could tell because of their demeanor, she's an educator, that they were the quieter, the shyer kids, and she asked them what they liked about it. Because, you know, that's often, I think to your point earlier, that distractibility, the quiet, like how do those kids do it? And a handful of them said that they liked the flexible space because even if they weren't with their one friend, see where they were. Like it made them feel secure, that they knew where their friends were, right? That they were still there, right? So they needed them, which it was really an unintended kind of way for us.
We're always pushing our teachers to share what they're learning and to share their learning with other teachers. So when we moved 6B and C to a more flexible space, we had them work with 6A to learn, and we worked with 6B and C the second time. So this is some of the things that they said. And then we had some parents as well.
Can I just ask a question, since that's one of my questions is, I mean, I'm a supporter of the environment, but then as they move into other grades, how will you continue?
We're going to get there.
Okay. So,
and as the leadership team, you know, this is massive change for our school, right? And it's institutional change. It's not a little minor change. It's truly disruptive, right? And the biggest disruption is the way that teachers have to work. Teaching has been a very private, isolated profession for hundreds of years. Go into your room, you've got your group. You know, it actually used to be competitive. My kids did better on the reading assessments than yours did, so I'm a better teacher. Right? Like not, oh gosh, your kids didn't learn as much. Let's work together so we can make sure everybody learns a lot. Right? Like there was this. And so working around that, this is my space, I put my rugs and my decorations and my stuff, and it's about
my thing. That's been our biggest challenge. And making up the team and making sure that we have the right variety of skills and personalities, the soft skills as well as the academic expertise is really something that we're really focused on. So our recruiting, we are fortunate. We know we have our teachers like to work in our middle schools, so we don't get a lot of resignations, but when we do, we are very, very specific on what we look for to the team that they will be on, right? So we're really working on that. Our coaches do a lot of work with our team. We support them all the time.
What we found is that our teams are, you know, 6A, 7B, whatever it is, they used to be really good at cooperating and coordinating. They would make sure that the kids were in the right place at the right time, but it was when we pushed to this collaboration. That idea of supporting a shared vision, that's where the works is really, really heavy. It's where the heavy lifting comes for us and the coaches, because there is still this sense of my subject, my time,
my kids.
And so reframing that, as Lauren said, around it being the kids.
Yeah, I mean, and a good analogy that we use with teachers around this is the difference between like a group and a team, right? So if you play golf and you've gone out to play golf with, you know, with other people in that foursome, you're a group, you're cooperating in terms of, you know, who's taking what stroke and so on, and you're coordinating your movement, but actually my results have nothing to do with the results of anybody else. It's still an individual activity. I'm just coordinating my play with other people, and it's more fun to do that and so on and so forth, as opposed to a more traditional team sport where the results of the team rely on the results of the individuals.
So as the question has come up a couple of times now, all of our sixth grade has been renovated. We also know that we talked about three silos, right? Time, space, and subject. Time and subject can still be worked on by any teacher in this school without, even if they don't have the advantage of the space. The space helps us do it more easily, as Chris said earlier. But it doesn't mean we can't do it. Our schedules are designed so that they can flex for any grade. They were designed that way purposefully. So our challenge this year is for our teams to black out their bingo boards, and you can see that across the different, there's all sorts of elements of the instruction and the practices that go towards the work we're trying to do, so that as we move and we begin to renovate other spaces, the teams of teachers have already tried the things, are already getting better at the things that they'll be able to do, and they'll be like, "Woo! Finally, now we have the space to do all of it," and they can get there. What are we going to do next? These are some books, and we'll make sure that this gets a PDF of the slideshow gets put in the e-news if you want to. Those are some of the books that kind of led our thinking as we were working on this, some of the resources that we use. Go to the next slide. Next steps. Next year. I thought I had put something in there. I had one. So next year we will, over the summer, we are going to do one of our seventh grade teams. We've found that we think that the capacity that we have with our coaches and our teacher librarian to support the teachers in the first year or two of the work, we feel like if we go beyond three teams in the first or second year, that we will not be able to give them what they need in terms of the kind of regular support. So we did 6A last year and B and C this year. That means we have three teams that are in their first or second year working collaboratively in this new space. Next year, we kind of will release 6A to the wild. Not totally, but they won't get as much support as they have been. And we'll focus on a new seventh grade team and continue the second year support of 6B and C. And then with the remainder of the seventh grade the following summer, so that we don't ever have more than three teams at a time. And then eighth grade will really be dependent on the facilities master planning, what the board's decisions are in terms of if, when, timeline, where the middle school is in the phasing. So we have eighth graders on 8A who the two ELA teachers are already working together. So we're in the process now of identifying the team for seventh grade. It may not be a pure team that exists now. We ask teachers to apply to be kind of the pathfinder for our grade level. So that we can get the right people in those seats that really want to try it, that, or the, and then the other people that want to wait and see what happens first and learn from everybody else, that, that it was just totally fair, right? Because it's super hard work. So that's where we are for the summer. So we'll have one of our seventh grade teams on. We don't, the footprint's different, so we don't know exactly what it will look like. In the sixth grade footprint of the classrooms was pretty easy to renovate. The seventh and eighth grade are a little bit more challenging in terms of their hallway spaces and stuff, so we're going to have to figure that out with our facilities.
So we're hoping you're leaving with an understanding that a flexible learning environment isn't just the physical space, but it's actually subject and time, and that as we have some spaces where it's done more easily, we're working with our teachers to bring elements of that flexible learning environment in.
To every classroom, every team. Yes.
And we will hang around for, I think, for a little bit. Do you have any questions? We're sorry we kept you a little bit long, but really are appreciative that you came, and hope that you have a great rest of your time.
Thank you, Lindsay.
I mean, I think it's a lot of the other things. One great, this year.